mini conference, of which he promises us there'll be another in the spring. And we're delighted to have Fred Cohen, who's visiting at Penn for the fall semester and at the Institute for Advanced Studies in the spring semester, talking on spaces of particles, their applications, and connections. Fred.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it. So the motivation for the subject of this talk is some actually connections with conversations I've had with various people in this audience. The talk itself is based on a theorem that's a few years old, but I want to say how some things fit. So this lecture is about Artin's brain group. Now I'm going to have a fair number of slides which are pictures of braids to make sure that everybody understands what this is about, because the structures turn out to be very elementary looking. I'm going to talk about paths of particles milling around in a plane. We'll see what that means in just a moment. And then I'm going to give a connection to homotopy theory. So by homotopy theory, I mean a little bit of the kinds of things that Gareth talked about in the first lecture, like the fundamental group of the topological space, or its second homotopy group, or its higher homotopy group. I'll say more about that, to be precise, in a few moments. Okay. So there's a crude picture of a three-stranded braid. Now, what that is supposed to be is, think of that disc at the top of the cylinder. Think of three particles, three distinct particles, and then as these particles move through time, they move down, and as long as the particles are not allowed to collide, they give you a picture of something called a braid, which, you know, you might cavalierly think these are a frivolous object, but, you know, what can be interesting about braids? Well, let's see if I can say something about that. I'm not accustomed to this device yet.
Move the wheel towards yourself.
Okay, gotcha. Okay, the main point of this lecture is that somehow keeping track of particles milling about through time in the plane corresponds to giving maps between spheres which are of varying dimensions, but then considering those maps up to continuous deformations. So that's an object that people have studied off and on for over 100 years. In fact, we'll see it goes back before that to some work of Poincaré. The braid groups give a possibly different picture of what homotopy groups look like. So I'm now going to say a bit about that. Artin was the formally invented the braid groups in a paper in 1924 in the Hamburg. So much of this lecture is about Artin's braid groups. Well, what are they? So I'm going to use a similar picture. Think of three particles in that picture, three particles at the top of this cylinder, and then cut the cylinder with a horizontal knife. And what happens if you look at the paths of these particles moving through time, and you cut a braid, you end up having an intersection of three points. So you're just thinking of a braid as a graph of some path of particles moving through time. Now, I want to look at some naive, very simple looking braids. In this particular braid, that's supposed to be a picture of a braid with K strands, and its feature is that all of the strands are vertical except for two of them, the ith and the I plus first, and you can imagine swapping the ith and I plus first. So that looks like a very elementary braid. Now, Artin gave a presentation of the braid group. So by the braid group, I mean think of all possible braids. Now, I've lied to you a little bit. You have to, two braids are equivalent if one can be transformed to another by tightening up the strings a little bit. So there actually is an equivalence relation on the pictures that I've not elaborated on. Artin saw that there were two relations. The first one is that sigma I, sigma I plus 1, sigma I is sigma I plus 1, sigma I, sigma I plus 1. Now, if I had some stage props here, I would actually make the braids to do this, but you can go home and try that, and you'll see it works very easily. So that relation is satisfied. And then that last relation, that sigma I, sigma j, commutative I and j differ by 2, is also instant. But Artin's theorem is that that's a presentation. That is, the braid group is generated by these braids that swap the I and I plus first strand and satisfy those relations. Okay, so now we have some formal idea of what the braid group is. Now, the braid group is the fundamental group of a certain space that I'm going to talk about a little bit now. So this lecture is really about configuration spaces. Now, what are configuration spaces? The formal definition of the mth configuration space of particles in M is just ordered k-tuples of points in M where the ith and the jth are not equal if I is not equal to j. So it looks like a very elementary construction. Namely, take the product M with itself k times and then remove all diagonals. So you can imagine, why is this an interesting space? I mean, when you first see it, you might think, you can say everything there is you might want to know about this space. It looks like a very elementary gadget. And we're going to see, I hope, by the end of the lecture, that it's really hiding some delicate features. It's hiding some delicate features. So now, instead of looking at ordered k-tuples of points, instead of looking at ordered k-tuples, you can imagine commuting them and then quotienting out the configuration space by the action of the symmetric group. So you could consider the space, the topological space, of unordered k-tuples of distinct points. Now, various people, in fact, in this room have called these things various different things. So the unordered configuration space is sometimes called the unlabeled configuration space, or the ordered configuration space is sometimes called the labeled configuration space. Now, I may get the terminology interchanged somewhere in the lecture, but there's a warning. Okay, so now, what can we say about these configuration spaces? Well, let's look at the special case where the manifold is the complex numbers. So we're going to consider the space of unordered k-tuples of distinct points in the complex numbers. Now, this is a space that you probably had thought about in high school if you thought about spaces. So what space is this? What is this? Well, let's start off with polynomials. So I know you thought about polynomials in high school and probably before that. So think of monic. Think of monic polynomials of degree k with complex coefficients. So there's a rumor that those can be factored into linear factors over the complex numbers. Namely, it's a product of x or z minus ri, where ri is a root. So now I want to think of the space of all such polynomials. So we're going to think of all polynomials of degree k, leading coefficient 1, and the other coefficients are arbitrary. Well, so you know what those spaces are. Oops. If you just regard a polynomial as being given by its coefficients, well, that gives you an ordered k-tuple of points in the complex numbers, which is complex dimensional, it's k-dimensional complex space. It's just CK. On the other hand, If you identify the space of polynomials as the unordered k-tuples of its roots, then you can think of the space of polynomials as that so-called k-fold symmetric power. That is, the unordered k-tuples of points in the complex numbers. So the comparison is obvious. You have roots. Those completely describe the polynomial. And you have the associated coefficients. Now, there's a map from the coefficients to the roots. There's the classical map from the, the roots. I failed the exam. There's a classical map from the set of unordered k-tuples of roots to the ordered k-tuples of coefficients. That's the usual map that sends the roots to plus or minus the elementary symmetric functions in the roots. That map is a homeomorphism. It's a very beautiful map. A homework problem of Galois is to try to find an inverse for that map. So that's something you might try to understand. You have this very elementary map. Well, it becomes very compelling now. Okay, well, now inside of this space of roots, we could consider the configuration space of unordered k-tuples of distinct roots. Well, what is that space? That's exactly the space of monic polynomials of degree k with k distinct roots. So it is something you could have thought about very easily in high school. Well, what can you say about that space? What can you say about the space of unordered k-tuples of distinct roots? Well, I now want to extend this a little bit in order to answer the question I've just asked. I want to extend this a little bit to look at configurations of points in a surface. So you can imagine having a surface like the two-sphere, or a torus, or surfaces that came up in Gareth's lecture. You can imagine having configurations in other surfaces. Well, now, what I want to do is compare these spaces a little bit, and I also want to compare the fundamental groups. Now, what do you mean by the fundamental groups? The fundamental groups of the unordered configuration space basically consists of particles on the surface moving through time up to isotopy, that is, tightening up the strands a little bit. So the break group is really the fundamental group of the unordered configuration space. Now, I'd like to illustrate this a little bit with some pictures. And the fundamental comparison is something, again, that you could have considered in high school. Namely, you could compare the complex numbers to the two-sphere, the Riemann sphere, which is the complex numbers with a point added at infinity. So I think there should be a picture coming up of that. So there's the Riemann sphere sitting above, well, maybe the picture isn't so good. Think of this sphere, think of this table as the plane, and think of a basketball sitting on the plane. And you all know about stereographic projection from the north pole of a basketball to the plane. So you can think of the Riemann sphere, or in fact, the Riemann sphere is the plane with a point added at infinity. Now, why am I going on and on about things that you know about very well? Well, let's see if we can start to make a comparison. Oops. In order to make this comparison, I want to understand the Riemann sphere in a slightly better way. So the Riemann sphere, the two-sphere, can also be regarded as CP1. CP1 is the space of complex lines through the origin in complex two-space. and being aligned through the origin, an element in SL2C, that is the 2x2 complex matrices of determinant 1, act on a line by sending it to another line. So this gives you an action of the 2x2 matrices over the complex numbers, the 2x2 invertible matrices, on the space of lines through the origin. Well, we're going to look at that action a little bit also. So we're just going to think of 2x2 matrices as moving lines around, where a line corresponds to a point on the Riemann sphere. Okay. Oops. Now, I first want to look at configurations in the Riemann sphere. So this looks like some very innocent object. In particular, I want to think of ordered triples of distinct points on the unit sphere. So ordered triples, x, y, and z, that are all distinct. Now, you all know about PSL2C. That's SL2C divided out by its center. PSL2C is a group that appeared in work of Poincaré and others in an interesting way, and is going to be part of some wild speculation at the end of this talk. The configuration space of three points in the two-sphere is actually PSL2C in disguise. It's hiding PSL2C. So one way to see that is to just start off with three points on the Riemann sphere. The complex number 0, the complex number 1, and infinity. That gives you an ordered triple of three distinct points. PSL2C moves those three points around the configuration space. So you can ask, what is that? What is the orbit of this matrix group on the configuration space? It's exactly the configuration space. It's exactly the configuration space. There are many proofs of this that, in fact, go back to the 1860s. So this is a classical fact about three configurations in the two-sphere. So, PSL2C, I've given you a map from PSL2C to ordered triples of points in the three-sphere. Now, PSL2C contains the Lie group SO3. It's just the rotation group. PSL2C contains SO3. So you can imagine forming the quotient space. Well, you can also imagine taking the space of three particles in the sphere and having SO3 act on those particles diagonally. That is, if I have three particles and a rotation, then apply that same rotation to all three particles at once. And now you can quotient out and ask, what do you get? What do you get? And the remark is that PSL2C modulo SO3 is exactly the configuration space of three points modulo SO3. What is that space? Well, there are some physics friends in here who look at that space inside and out. That's sometimes called one sheet of hyperbolic free space. Namely, it's the four tuples in R4. The four tuples in R4 satisfying that metric, that t squared minus the sum of x squared plus y squared plus z squared is 1, where t is bigger than 0. Now, why does this come up in this initial setting that I mentioned at the beginning of the lecture? How does this have anything to do with homotopy or maps of spheres to spheres? So that's what we're going to start on next. We're going to try to see how these simple constructions of particles moving around in the plane and particles moving around in the sphere have some connection to homotopy. Oh, just one quick remark. This is a technical remark. Configurations of k points in the two-sphere where k is bigger than or equal to 3, modulo this natural action of the rotation group is again a product of hyperbolic free space and some other configuration space. Oh, there's a misprint. I've lied to you. If you take the complex numbers, infinity is not one of the points that's in the complex numbers. So that should have been the complex numbers minus 0, 1. Sorry about that. So that splits as hyperbolic free space cross configurations in the plane punctured twice. Okay, one goal of this lecture is to compare braids for the plane and braids for the two-sphere. Now, why would anybody want to do this, especially in this audience? So this looks like a very elementary question. So let's now try to understand that a little bit. What do I mean by comparing the two? Well, that first picture, that upper cylinder is a picture of a braid in the plane. Namely, think of this as particles moving through time, which are not allowed to collide at any time t. So I can think of that upper picture as a three-stranded braid for the plane. On the other hand, if I just think of the top of that cylinder as a little patch, a coordinate patch in the Riemann sphere, and the bottom of the cylinder as a coordinate patch of a small sphere inside of the big sphere, well, there's a natural map which turns that braid in the plane to the braid in the two-sphere. It just embed the plane in the two-sphere and look at what happens on the level of configuration spaces. Does that picture make sense to folks? Clear to everybody? Okay, so that's the picture I want to look at. That's exactly the picture I want to look at. So let's look at that top braid. Well, you all know by inspection that that top braid is a non-trivial braid. I mean, how do you unbraid it? Well, you can't. You can't. How about that braid on the two-sphere? How do you unbraid that? Well, that's the so-called Dirac spring problem. And now, let's see, I better not take my belt off and do it. So I think what I'm going to do is unbraid it in a picture. So let's look at that braid. So that's a trivial braid on the sphere. Where did that braid come from? It's that lower braid on the sphere, which has been cleaned up a little bit. Okay, so why is that braid trivial? Why is that braid trivial? Well, this is this classic trick. Namely, start with that green strand. That green strand is poking up on the sphere like this. You can imagine taking that green strand and just moving it down to the bottom of the sphere. And what happens when you do that? What happens when you move that green strand around? That's the picture that you get. Now, grab a hold of that inside two-sphere and untwist it, leaving the vertical strand fixed. What does that tell you? That braid is trivial. Why is that interesting? Why is that an interesting process? Okay, so the previous two slides show you that if you think of the three-stranded braid group, so BR sub K, as mentioned earlier, is the K-stranded braid group. The three-stranded braid group for the complex numbers, again, there's a misprint. R2 should have been the complex numbers, but they're not wildly different in this context. So there's a map of the three-stranded braid group for the planes and the three-stranded braid group or the two-sphere. And what we saw was that there was a three-stranded braid that was non-trivial for the plane that got sent to this obviously trivial braid on the two-sphere. So how and why is this interesting? Well, let's see. So I want to start looking at objects like the Borromean rings. What are the Borromean rings? Well, there's a picture. What's a feature of the Borromean rings? If you take any one of those circles away, they come apart. Exactly come apart. Well, I now want to look at something that, I guess the title of this slide is Borromean creatures, rather than Borromean rings. So you can imagine there are other sorts of Borromean objects, like Borromean brains. So I want to now talk a little bit about Borromean brains. So as I said, one property of the Borromean links is that if you remove any one of the links, then what's left falls apart, can be separated. You can also think of the notion of a Borromean braid. What could that possibly mean? Well, if you start off with a braid and remove any strand, you can imagine the braid falling apart. Let's call the set of Borromean braids, maybe this is bad notation, but let's call it Bor sub K. So, Bor sub K of S denotes the Borromean braids for a surface. And now the rest of this lecture is about Borromean braids. What can you say about them, and why would you even be interested in them? Why would you be interested in Borromean braids? First of all, are there any Borromean braids? Well, you have to say yes, right? Let's see if we can find one. That looks like a Borromean braid. Let's see. Let's test. Well, what happens if you delete the right-hand strand? If you delete the right-hand strand, then even I can get that correct today. You've got two vertical strands, which is rumored to be a trivial braid. Now, let's remove the left-hand braid. What happens? Well, you now have a vertical braid, and then a braid which looks like it has a tongue sticking out that you can pull back, and then another tongue sticking out which you can pull back, and so you have two vertical strands again. And a similar story happens with the second strand. If you delete the second strand, this braid becomes trivial. So now you know that there are Borromean braids out there. Are there many of them? Or what are they? Well, some people in this audience have in fact worked on Borromean braids. Let's see if this next slide has the example. Let's look at the second example, the Borromean four-stranded braid for the two-sphere. So now you know what that is. I didn't draw any four-stranded braids for the two-sphere in the pictures. But I'm asserting that the four-stranded Borromean braid group for the two-sphere is something else. It's some other group that some folks in here have studied called the principal congruent subgroup of level 4 in SL2Z. What can that possibly mean? So SL2Z is the group of 2x2 matrices over the integers with determinant plus 1. So they're just 4x4 matrices of determinant plus 1 with integer coefficients. What is principal congruent subgroup of level 4 mean? Well, you can imagine taking each entry in the matrix and reducing it modulo 4. So the entries of the matrices were required to be in the integers. You could reduce them mod 4 and then ask, what do you get after you reduce them mod 4? And what it means to be in the principal congruent subgroup is that the mod 4 reduction of the diagonal entries are both 1s and the anti-diagonal entries are zero. They're zero. Various people have studied this group, like Felix Klein, for example, and it turns out that this group principal congruent subgroup of level four is a free group on five letters. It's exactly a free group on five letters. And it actually comes up for natural reasons. This is not a crazy fact. This actually arises for a completely natural reason using a construction in the world of low-dimensional topology called a mapping class group. So this is not an anomaly. It's just a reasonably straightforward, accessible example. Now, what are the other creatures? What about Borum A and K on a surface? Well, it is usually, not always, but it is usually a countably, infinitely generated free group. So for folks who like free groups, that seems like a reasonable description. But it's a reasonably complicated combinatorial object. And in fact, one of the things, homework problems you can set for yourself is write down or describe a set of generators. You might ask, why would anybody in their right mind, or maybe anybody, why would anybody want to find a list of the generators? Well, that's a reason is going to come shortly. But when you try to count these, when you try to count what the generators are, you encounter problems that people encountered in the beginning of the 20th century and a little bit earlier, namely counting ordered partitions of integers. You end up counting things like ordered partitions of integers. I'll say more about that later in the section on wild speculation. So we now know what the Borromean braids for a surface look like, and a little bit about them in one case, and in fact, in most cases, but I have not been precise about what most means here. Okay, now, the first homework problem is to look at the Borromean braid group for the complex numbers to the Borromean braid group for the two-sphere. So we've already looked at this homomorphism from the braid group of the plane to the braid group of the two-sphere, and you can see that that preserves Borromean braids. What happens on the level of Borromean braids? Why would that be interesting to anybody? Well, these maps on the level of Borromean braid groups are the subject of some work that John Barrick, Ji Wu, Yan Lai Wang, and myself did, trying to compare these two. So we're now looking at this simple map from configurations of k points in the complex line to k configurations in the two-sphere, and asking, what do those maps do on the level of fundamental groups and on the level of these subgroups given by Borromean braids? So here is a theorem about the Borromean braid groups. Think of that natural inclusion and think of the image of the k-stranded Borromean braids for the complex numbers in the Borromean k-stranded braids for the Riemann sphere. Now that map is not an embedding. It's not one-to-one. It is a map. It is a map. And now you can ask about the image of that map. Now there's a theorem that says that image, the image of that map is a normal subgroup. So you all know what a normal subgroup is. Now you can form the quotient group. What is that quotient group? That is, what is the quotient group of the Borromean k-stranded braids for the two-sphere modulo the Borromean k-stranded braids for the line? Well, the theorem is that that group is something called pi k minus 1 of the two-sphere. That's the k minus first homotopy group of the two-sphere. I've lied to you a tiny bit. You need to assume that k is bigger than or equal to 5 for this to happen. What are these homotopy groups? What is the definition of pi k minus 1 of the two-sphere? Well, I'll start off with the K minus one sphere. That is the set of points in Euclidean K space of norm one. And think of the homotopy classes of maps of that sphere to the two sphere. Now, these are objects that people have been studying pretty hard, actually, off and on, since about the 1930s. Chet defined the higher homotopy. Oh, I think Poincaré defined the fundamental group. And I think Chet defined the higher homotopy groups, but he dismissed them. He thought that they weren't interesting because they were abelian. So Chet basically did not continue studying this. Horavitz then went off and proved the Horavitz theorem, where people could compute a few homotopy groups. And, the subject has been continuing since then. Heinz Hopf found that pi 3 of S2 was not zero, using constructions similar to what we talked about earlier. So now what's happening is that people have tried hard to get some hold on what these homotopy groups are. Let me recall a few features of these homotopy groups. And by the way, before I forget, in Ali's talk, he gave the definition. And in the previous talk, Ali gave a definition of what homology is. Well, it turns out there's a version, a non-abelian version of homology. There's a non-abelian version that John Moore defined in the Carton seminars almost 60 years ago. And what's happening with the Bray groups, if you do some non-abelian homological algebra, whatever that means, those are the answers you get out. Now, let me say a few more words about what's known about these homotopy groups. I mean, is anything known? Well, the first roughly 40 homotopy groups are known by, really, from my point of view, heroic work. It's really not so easy. What else is known? Let's see. So, there is a lot of work of some sort going on involving these things. Serre made one of the big steps forward in this subject in his thesis. One of Serre's theorems, or a special case of one of Serre's theorems, is that pi k minus 1 of the 2 sphere is a finite group. It's a finite group as long as k minus 1 is at least 4. So as I said, Chet showed that these groups are abelian. Serre showed that pi k minus 1 is a finite abelian group. And now you can ask, well, what are the finite abelian groups out there that you know? Well, there's Z mod 2Z, there's Z mod 4Z, Z mod 8Z, a few others. Now you can ask, which one of these appear in the homotopy groups? Well, it turns out that in the homotopy groups of the two-sphere, there are infinitely many non-trivial finite abelian groups. There are infinitely many elements of order 2. So there's a lot of Z2s somewhere in this world. There are a lot of Z4s. But there are no elements of order 8. And thus, no elements of order 16. So it's not quite a vector space, unless you regard modules over Z4 as vector spaces. It's almost a vector space. What about the p-torque? What about the Z3s or Z9s? Well, it turns out there are infinitely many Z3s, but there are no Z mod 9Zs in it. So there's no p-squared torsion in the homotopy. And so it's known that these groups have some general structure bounding the torsion. It's known that they never quit. There's a little bit qualitative known of this sort, and there's a little bit known about the actual groups. The first 40 groups or so have been computed by a number of people. Well, what does this tell you? This gives you a theorem about the Borromean braid groups. It's telling you something qualitative about the Borromean braids and how they compare. So basically, one of my homework problems to you is there something about the Bray group that's giving you information about the homotopy groups of the two-sphere? So can you go the other way? Is this an accident that the Bray groups are somehow informing on the homotopy groups of the two-sphere? And again, I've not been direct. It turns out that a similar process works for every sphere. But the combinatorics get very complicated. So this is probably the simplest formulation of this sort of setting. There was a comment about the higher torsion in the homotopy groups of spheres. So the torsion cannot be too bad. So for example, if you just knew the size, if you knew the size of these quotients of the Borromean Bray groups, you'd compute all the p-torsion for p and I prime in the homotopy groups of the two-sphere. So knowing the size would be a very interesting thing to be able to understand. So I want to say a little bit more. I want to say this in a slightly more technical language. So the theorem that Barrick, Wu, Wong, and I proved is that there's a short exact sequence of groups. What do I mean by that? I mean that the K-stranded Borromean Bray group for the two-sphere maps onto this unknown group, this homotopy group of the two-sphere. And the kernel of that map, the kernel, the elements in the Borromean, K-stranded Borromean Bray group for the two-sphere, that gets sent to the identity, come from the Borromean braids on the plane. Come exactly from the Borromean braids on the plane. And then we saw earlier that there was a kernel from the Borromean, or from the braids on the plane, to the braids on the sphere. And you can ask what the kernel of that map is. Well, it turns out it's exactly the Borromean K plus 1 stranded braids for the two-sphere. Now somebody should say, how the dickens can this happen? How do you map a K plus 1 stranded braid to a K-stranded braid? Well, back at the beginning of the lecture, I mentioned something about the configuration space really being a disguise for PSL2C. And so what you end up doing is essentially canceling off some strand by quotienting out by PSL2C. So Poincaré's map actually gives that map from the Borromean K plus 1 stranded braids and the two-sphere to the Borromean K stranded braids. So that's where PSL2C starts to fit in a little bit. Well, one of the things I want to say is that this exact sequence has not been useful for computing anything. And if you try to do something in this kind of world, well, you know, some people are addicted to computing answers. And so now I'm going to make some wild speculation, having tried hard to compute some answers. Explicit computations have been very tricky. Now, usually what people do is cook up some gadget called a spectral sequence and really try hard to make it run. But it essentially objects at every stage. It is not a very compliant spectral sequence. But you might, instead of trying to use some fancy tools, some very sophisticated tools, you might try to do this with your bare hands. How do you do that with your bare hands? Well, it's very much like what Ali was doing in his lecture earlier. There is something called the simplicial group. There's a kind of homological algebra associated to this. You try to compute kernels, you try to compute cycles and boundaries, and you find that the cycles in some world are exactly the Borromean braids. So it turns out that when you try to compute these things by hand, what you're actually working with is the Borromean braids, just up front. And so in trying to calculate this, you run up against problems, as I mentioned earlier, like counting partitions. What did people classically do when you try to count partitions of an integer? I mean, if I walked up to you in the street and I gave you the integer n, and I asked you, what are the ordered partitions of n? What does that mean, first of all? Let's start off with n equal to 6. What do you mean by an ordered partition of n? Well, you might mean a non-decreasing set of integers, like 1, 2, 3, which add up to 6. Well, how many ways can you do that? Well, when n is equal to 6, we can all probably do it. But what is it for all n? That's a non-trivial, interesting problem that connects to many subjects in mathematics. So, I want to start to end this lecture with some wild speculation, trying to understand this kind of counting of partitions. That is, let brackets around the Borromean braid groups denote their order. So these are, as I mentioned earlier, finite abelian groups as long as K is sufficiently big. There are two of them that are not finite, and I'm just throwing them away. They're really not relevant. Pi 2 and pi 3 are copies of the integers. So I'm just throwing those away. And now you could look at that generating function. And my naive question is that function analytic? Do these actions of PSL2C on the configuration space translate to some interesting invariant action on this, hopefully, analytic function? And can those coefficients of this function somehow be estimated with classical methods? Thanks very much. Enjoy this.
So we're certainly open to questions and comments. Peter.
I'm having trouble composing Borromean braids and getting a Borromean braid unless I add pure braids.
So let's see if I can make a picture.
I'll make pure braids.
So let's.
Look, the generators of the braid group are Borromean, unless you mean pure braids.
The generators are. Unless I mean what?
Pure braids.
I mean pure.
Okay.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Absolutely. So,
okay, I'm happy.
No, that's absolutely right.
As in your picture.
As
right,
in your picture.
As in the picture.
That's
right. So, Peter, I have to say, I'm embarrassed to say, I've never thought about Borromean two-stranded braids. I thought they were all the trivial ones. Good, good. Or I may have three-stranded braids for the plane, for example, or a count of many internally generated three groups.
Stop the questions. I was sort of confused by your exact sequence. You said you use PSL2C,
right.
That should knock off,
so
that should knock off three particles, not one particle.
Here's what happens. So you essentially can compute what happens on the level of fundamental groups after you collapse out by PSL2C. PSL2C doesn't have, has a Z2 as a fundamental group, which turns out to be thrown away in the world of Borromean braids. So you can essentially ignore that. And now if you take K plus 1 configurations in the 2 sphere and divide out by PSL2C, what you saw is you got K minus 2 configurations in the plane punctured twice, which is
oh, okay.
not the equivalent
put the 2 points
to
back.
K configurations in the plane
okay.
when you cross it with a circle.
Okay, okay, okay.
That's the math.
Okay,
that's exactly the math. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay.
Anyone else? Do you have a reason to ask for this? That this function might be analytic? Is it something like a zeta function?
Well, so what I keep trying to do and not succeeding with, well, if I had succeeded, I would have reported on that. What I'm trying to do is apply some function and apply a circle method to it. So the only reason is numerology. I don't have a solid mathematical reason for doing that, other than when you actually try to compute, you end up trying to kind of transition in some ways. And so it's just basically superstition in one way.
what, if I understand correctly, you're really asking about the order of growth of K, of those numbers by K minus 1. Because well, if you have a 1 over K factorial, if you knew the order of growth, you could prove a positive radius of convergence.
Right, right.
You won't exactly. From your
exactly. So I'm asking about that, first of all. So when you actually, in the actual computations, they don't grow too quickly. But when you're actually working with these things, you have to at least fiddle inside of a free Lie algebra or a free group or something that's pretty big. And what happens is most things get killed off. So you're trying to get some control over that. And the thing about, the reason that this thing was so interesting to me at least about the classical partition problem is that trying to analyze poles gave you a good way of this generating function, the partition function, gave you a good way to estimate coefficients.
You could try the formal Mellon transform and see if that makes the problem any easier.
So I think I don't know what that is. Maybe we can talk about that afterwards.
I mean, that's formal because you don't know the stamping convergence.
Right, that's exactly right.
So, I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
If you have a braid that's not Borromean,
yes.
And you think about taking out each one of the individual strands.
So first of all, let me just make a remark before we go further. So Peter was asking about the generators. I require pure braids to start with. In other words, braids that start at some point and the same strand quits where it started. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense?
Sure.
So I'm now restricting to those. Sorry,
maybe my question doesn't make any sense, but hopefully you make enough sense. I'm trying to ask the question is, if you think about taking a non-Borromean braid, thinking about all the braids with one less strand you can get by removing one strand, can you recover the braid from that information?
No.
So you can't for a Borromean, obviously, because it's all trivial every time.
No. So there's... So that's actually, you're doing this, you're hiding this non-abelian homological algebra that I mentioned. It turns out that, I'll say quickly, I don't want to keep people with this technical business. Namely, the pure braid groups from plane form something called the simplicial group. And the Borromean braids are exactly the so-called Mohr cycles of the simplicial group. So now you're trying to say, well, how do you recover a braid from this process of the leading strand? And there's lots of choices. So I think the answer to your question is that there are different choices.
For a non-Borromean braid, just compose the form.
Right.
So you're doing everything on this too. You could presume you do Borromean braids in any topological space.
On any topological space. So I didn't want to mention this.
Conjecture that you just get homotopy groups.
You get other things. So in fact, some of this bears on work that Herman, Dennis Tatarik, some of Herman's students, and other people did, where they're studying linking invariants. It turns out if you look at configurations in R3, and you start looking at maps of products and circles in you end up measuring something similar, but it's kind of more in the world of Borromean rings. And what you get out from this is an interesting representation called the Lie representation of the symmetric groups. But what I'm trying to say, and I'm not saying very well, is that your question is very interesting. It connects to many different things, but we probably better quit and maybe be more precise outside the lecture.
Sam?
Have you ever thought about localizing these things at different primes and see that you
get
vector space? So if you had an idea of what the size was, then you really have.
Well, there are some people in this audience who do things like that. So that instead of looking at braid group, you might look at its profinite completion or its pro P completion.
But I mean, that's already.
That's huge.
That's huge. That's
but it turns out to capture very interesting phenomena.
Somewhat that's not natural. If you take the usual localization, that's
I don't know how to localize this. I mean, that would be an interesting thing if you could do it.
No other questions. So thank Fred again.